Thank you. celebrate the installation of our new pastor, Pastor Ruben. With us tonight, we have some special participants that are helping us celebrate this occasion. Tonight, with us, we have the Reverend Dave Spencer. Pastor Dave Spencer is a longtime friend of Pastor Cabrera.
Area of missionaries here in your community. We're grateful that we were able to spread the gospel to our brothers and sisters here in Greater Gardner area. And Lord, we're grateful that you have shown godly men to our church to help us through this time of transition. We're grateful for the leadership of George Cole, who showed us many things and how to recognize the direction that we as a church body wanted to go. And we're grateful for his leadership in prayer. And we're grateful that you have seen fit to use him as a minister of your gospel in Wellesley. Lord, we're grateful for Pastor Davis Stolfi, who came at a providential time once Pastor Cole left, and truly seen an example of your grace. And we're grateful that through him, we were able to continue our journey of sanctification. We're grateful that through him, we were able to continue learning about mercy towards our neighbors. Lord, and we're just so grateful that through him, we were able to transition seamlessly to our new pastor, Ruben Cabrera. And Father, we lift up our thanks that you have led this godly man here to our doors. And we pray that you continue to do a mighty work through him. We pray that he preaches Christ and him crucified. We pray that you keep your hand of protection on his family. And Lord, we pray that you let your Holy Spirit dwell in each one of our hearts. And we beg for an individual and corporate revival here at Bethany Baptist Church. Father in heaven, we send up these thanks and we pray this in your resurrected Son's most holy name. Amen. Amen. A lot of invitations that were sent out and numerous replies came back to people that could not attend. And I'll read some of these. Pastor Jonathan Kaminsky from Higher Ground sent a card. We extend our sincere congratulations to you and your church family as you celebrate becoming a pastor. Dr. Donald Duray. Ruben was a member of my church in New Jersey as a young man. A man of outstanding integrity and effort in performing pastoral duties in ministry. Dr. John Singleton, Associate Pastor at Gordon Conwell, on this happy occasion of the installation of Ruben Cabrera as your pastor, we at Gordon Conwell Theological Seminary send our joy along to join your joy in having Ruben present as your pastor. Reverend Ray Medeiros, thank you for your gracious invitation. We at the First Congregational Church of Westminster rejoice that you and your congregation have been led by the Holy Spirit to this decision. May God bless this new chapter in your ministry. Pastor Sam Gertz and the congregation at Montvale Evangelical Free Church, congratulations on your call to Bethany Baptist Church. You and your family have been an amazing blessing to us at Montvale Evangelical Free Church this past year, and we hate to see you go. But our loss is their gain. Thank you for your preaching, teaching, prayer, and one-on-one ministry to the members of our congregation. In a short time, you touched so many lives. You will always receive a warm welcome anytime you are back in this area, and you will be in our prayers. And finally, from Reverend Andy Needham, who's the Interim District Executive Minister for Conversion Northeast. Bethany Baptist Church has a rich and beautiful heritage of faithful and fruitful gospel ministry in the Greater Gardner region. You have been important co-laborers in the work of Conversion Northeast for many decades. Through the joys and challenges of local church ministry, what has never changed is your dedication to stand on the Word of God and the good news of salvation in Jesus Christ. Today you mark an important new chapter in that story as you officially install Pastor Cabrera to lead and shepherd the body. We celebrate with you. Praise the Lord.
And
we're invincible. Those armies, those gods couldn't do anything against us, so here we are.
Yeah.
And Daniel comes in after the handwriting on the wall, and basically Daniel says this to me. He says, but you, Belshazzar, his son, have not humbled himself. You knew all this, but basically you didn't do anything. Now my ignoring what I knew about buying a bathing suit or buying any item of clothing meant that I had to go back up to LB and get another suit. But for Belshazzar, this meant that he was actually going to lose his life, lose the kingdom, and those closest to him would probably lose their lives. And as Daniel explains all this, and he explains what's going on when it comes to the handwriting on the wall, he says, here's what these words mean. Meaning God has numbered the days of your reign and brought it to an end. Tigal, you have been weighed on the scales and found wanting. Paris, your kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and the Persians. And as we looked at this summer, and as I thought about knowing better, and as I thought about starting a new ministry, and as I thought about Reuben, Reuben's the guy I call often when I have a theological question, when I have a, what do you think this implication is, and those kinds of things. So I looked to Reuben as a man that gets good counsel and good advice. And so as I thought about this time together, I said, there were some things that were at the place that we just now know better, and we should know better. And for Belshazzar, you know, again, I already mentioned what was at stake. But as you think about what he says, Daniel says, there's three ideas that seem to jump off the page. So Reuben, just thinking about these things. The first one is this, is that our days are numbered. And we're getting to the age where we realize our days are numbered. We're not 30, we're not 40, 50, we're 52, 53. We're starting to realize that the clock is ticking. So we realize that as we look at our lives, we go, wow, we got less time than more time. And since our days are numbered, we need to make sure what we're involved with, how we spend our lives, really counts. Psalmist Moses says, teach us to number our days and recognize how few they are. Help us to spend them as we should. I don't know about you in the house, but we're in this place where we're empty nesters. Yes, people say, oh, isn't that so sad? We're like, no, it's not sad. It's great. We love seeing the kids at Christmas, Easter, you know, Thanksgiving, you know, maybe a little bit more than that. But hey, it's great just to be Cindy and I now. But when the girls were living with us, and this is hard to believe, they would take super long showers. I would go into rooms and find lights on. And now that our oldest have their own apartment, I just like to go up there, turn on lights, and leave the room. Open up the refrigerator door and just stand there, we can leverage that time. We can have a regarding human behavior. You're well thought out with processes and procedures and those kinds of things. But beware that sometimes all of us have these strengths that, if they're overplayed, can become weaknesses. Remember to enjoy your life as a pastor, but enjoy your life as a husband, as a dad. Do some fun things. Don't work 80 hours a week, 60 hours a week. Don't do that. Enjoy life. I know ministry is enjoyable, but have that balance. Don't have a life that's left wanting. You know, I love what Rick Warren says when he says, if you're burning the candle at both ends, you're not that light. Think about that. Also, next, the third one would be out of this story, and we're not diving into all the details straight up my word here, but we can't ignore the warning signs. For Belshazzar, the warning signs were all around him. The armies were all around. Yes, the city was secure, but if you know the rest of the story, they flock up one of the major rivers, the river drops, and they march right in the aqueduct system and come right into the city without much bloodshed. He just didn't see the warning signs. And they were so confident that it said that they couldn't even stop the invading army if they had dropped the gates in the river that fed their water system. But they were so confident that they weren't watching. They weren't looking at the warning signs. So when the water dropped, no one was there to lower the gates. And even if the gates had been lowered, the city would have been invaded. So we have to really watch the warning signs. In Proverbs, we read, a prudent person sees trouble coming and ducks. A simpleton walks in blindly and is clobbered. Again, we're not perfect. We don't know everything, Reuben. But there are things that we know. There are things that we know in our guts. It's funny, I guess there's weirdness. But, you know, I'm not an expert. You know, I've been in three churches over 30 years. And it's amazing, you know, as I've gone to another church, all of a sudden that same person is there that was in like a church ago, a teacher. Different face, different name, but wiring is pretty similar. And sometimes that's a real blessing. Oh yeah, that's like Jack. I loved Jack in South Portland. Or that's, oh no, I gotta be careful. We know things. And we feel things. And we just can't ignore them. Ignoring is like the manure that makes troubles grow. Think about that. It really is. And we've got to watch out for it. Ignoring is the manure, we could say, that makes churches die. If we just ignore that, we need to be aware of that. So we have to ask ourselves, and Belshazzar did not ask this, Reuben, and I know we talked about this, so we are asking these questions, but we have to ask the question, what is outside our gate? What is surrounding our city, if you will? What's out there? What are we ignoring? What is looking to destroy our life or a part of our life? Do we kind of know it, but we just ignore it? A book I have been listening to on Audible is called Canoeing the Mountains, Christian Leadership in Uncharted Territory. We haven't talked about it, so I want to buy it, but we probably already have it. You recognize it? So, okay. So anyway, that's kind of like so then good. So then you know these things. There are five lessons they talk about. They talk about understanding uncharted territory. The world in front of us is nothing like the world behind us. The things we were trained for is for a world that is disappearing. And so we have to understand that and respond to that. We cannot become become unstuck by trying harder. How often do we go back and try to do the thing that the world's changed? That doesn't seem to work anymore. Beyond the map skill set, when you're traveling on the map, this book is based on Lewis and Clark, when you're traveling on the map, we have to realize that no one is going to follow us unless they've off the map, unless they've trusted us on the map with the most basic things. Leading off the map is involved in that uncharted territory. Adaption is everything. Leadership is learning how to ask new questions. We've been too scared, too busy, or too proud to ask. We need to ask those questions. Relationships and resistance. I don't really like this one, but I agree with it. You can't go it alone, but you haven't succeeded until you've survived the sabotage. And it's going to happen. Sabotage is normal. In the midst of change, you haven't effectively changed unless you've been testing your change in the midst of sabotage. We need to expect it. We need to embrace it. We need to know it's not personal. And we need to focus on healthy, emotionally strong people, not the saboteurs. Also, transformation. Everybody will change, especially the leader. What we talked about, what we thought when we were in our late 20s, early 30s, middle 30s, 40s, etc., etc., is different today. Who we were back then is different. And so we need to change. We need to allow Christ to transform us as he transforms the churches we've been entrusted to lead and care for. You know, determine that we will never change. Determine what we will never change and then be prepared to change anything and everything else. Because there's too much at stake, at cost. I remember one time being at my parents' church, and it's a great church, and they were making some changes, and my dad's 87, and he has a Sunday school class, and it's a good-sized church, and they were meeting, and they were talking about some changes, and it was a senior citizens change class, and one person raises, and are we doing all these things for the young people? And he said it with irritation. And I was happy to be at the class, and I was sitting in the back, and I wasn't going to say anything. I wanted to stand up and said, you should be losing sleep over being connected and engaging with the young people. Yeah, it should bother you that much, not how to overdo that. So we need to be aware of that. We need to see transformation. I could like this little quote. Leadership is disappointing your own people at a rate that they can absorb. That's change is hard going to happen. So the lessons from Daniel 5, Belshazzar, is he should have known better. I should have known better. I should have tried on the babies. We need to remember that our days are numbered. Our lives are out of balance. It's easy for that to happen. And we must not ignore the warning signs. Remember, I love you.
tonight. It's my job, my role tonight to get the charge to the church. And I've known Reuben for, I was thinking about, I think it's 25 years. So I moved to New Hampshire from New York. I'm a New Yorker in 1993. So we met in 93 and I met Dave around the same time as well. And I just got to tell you, so I was a youth pastor for a whole bunch of years. And one of the things I had a chance to do, a privilege to do, was organize youth retreats, snow camps, and so forth for our movement. And when I moved to New York, I still organized some events in New Hampshire, but also New York. And I invited Ruben to come speak at our snow camp in New York. And he came, and he was gracious. He just did a wonderful job. And the next year, when it came time to organize the next snow camp, my students came and they said, who are we going to invite this year? And I said, well, this person, maybe this person, maybe this person. They're like, no. That guy from last year, Ruben, you got to invite him. Okay. Be happy to invite Ruben. And so I asked the question, I said, why? And I quote, this is what my students said to me, that dude is deep. That dude is deep, and he challenges me, and I like it. And so we have Ruben, I think, 3 years ago. So my charge today, as Dave did a great charge to Reuben, set the bar this high, Dave, thanks, appreciate that. My charge is to the church. All right, so I'd like to just give some comments and some really some challenge to you as a church. And I guess my first question is to the search committee. I'm just curious, who was on the search committee? All right, let's everybody look around. Great job, search committee. See this community around you come to know this.
embrace, you guys embrace each other, embrace the vision that God has given to Reuben, you will see people come to Christ as their Savior. It's not about numbers. It's not about people in the pews. It's about lives that have been changed for eternity. And Reuben's going to preach the gospel. People are going to get saved. And people are going to be baptized. And the numbers that you're going to start counting, I pray, church, the numbers you're going to start counting and looking to are the number of baptisms and the number of lives that have changed and the number of people that are going out and sharing the good news with their friends. That's when we can start applauding what Jesus is doing. So I want to encourage you with three things here at the very beginning. First of all, you need to pray for your pastor. You need to pray for your pastor. See, here's the deal. Here's what I've learned as a pastor. Now, I've been in full-time ministry for about 28 years. I'm a young buck to these guys, okay? So, for 28 years, I've been in ministry. I started when I was 5, and they had no understanding. Just turned 50 this past year, so I ran into ministry right out of Bible college. And I just know this. I have people praying for me. I have people that I know pray for me. I have people that come up to you, even on a weekly basis, say, "Pastor, I'm praying for you." And this lady in my church, I think she's 93. I'm not sure. She's in her 90s. She's got a squeaky old voice. She's got a squeaky little voice. Pastor Brandon. And she's a Red Sox fan, too, by the way. Pastor Brandon. Know you. It's going to take style and his counseling style and his be patient with him. And I tell you what, just as Dave said, you got gold. You got gold for this guy. Romans 3:23, as we know, says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." Church, we've all sinned, right? So none of us are perfect. All of us have fallen short. So does Reuben. Reuben's not perfect. Don't hold him up on a pedestal. Encourage him and challenge him and keep him accountable, but he's only a man. You need to walk with him, you need to pray with him. It'll take time. I tell you what, I know Reuben will do a great job. And then thirdly, just my third challenge to the church, is to participate alongside of your pastor. If you don't have the mentality that he's the higher good, don't have the mentality that we're paying him the big bucks, so he's the one that's got to do it all. It doesn't work that way. He'll burn out, you'll burn out. Shared this with my church this morning. Even worship. Worship is a verb. Worship is something that we do. We participate together. It's not a show. It's something we do together. I encourage you to participate with your pastor. 1 Corinthians 9:24 through 25 says this. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last. But we do it to get a crown that will last forever. God has called Reuben to be your pastor, Bethany Baptist Church. There'll be crowns someday. Many crowns someday that will be given, handed out because of the ministry of Barry and all of you. I encourage you to partner together. Share the gospel with your friends. He's going to stand up here on Sunday, every Sunday, Sunday after Sunday, and he's going to pour out his heart through his message. And you can guarantee you this, the guy's not winging it. Okay? Some pastors can wing it. I don't know, Dave's good. He's probably going to win it. I can't win it, okay? I got to prepare. And I just know Reuben isn't prepared. And so when he's going to deliver to you on a Sunday, he spent hours and hours of reading and prayer and preparation. And so when he gets up here and he delivers what God has given to him, be a participant. Take what he's sharing. Take what God is sharing with you and say, how does this apply to me? How can I put this into practice? And you will see your church grow. You will see your community. My final challenge really to us today is how about we together as a church say, God, we just want to serve you. We want to serve you wholeheartedly. We want to come around. We want to support our pastor and his wife and his family. We want to do this together. Church, are you ready to say that? Church, are you ready to partner and pray and participate in the pastor?
Yes.
Amen. Can I hear it? Just a loud, hearty amen.
Amen.
Living for Jesus. Say so five.
Verses 1, 2, and 4.
Red Sox. I've been rooting for the Red Sox since 1941. And Ted Williams hits 406. And my mother took me to the first game I ever saw was between the Red Sox and the Cleveland Indians. And Bob Feller was the pitcher for the Cleveland Indians, and Mickey Harris was the pitcher for the Boston Red Sox. And the score wound up 11-8, which you wouldn't think of with those great pitchers. But in any case, I guess I'm kind of partial to a baseball. My son is 48 years old, and he still plays baseball. And his wife told him that when he gets injured, she's going to retire him. Heavenly Father, thank you that in your kind providence, you have called Ruben A. Cabrera to become the pastor of our congregation, Bethany Baptist Church. We pray the best for him and his wife and family as they settle here in our area. From the beginning of his pastorate here, he has impressed me that he possesses a pastor's heart. He has demonstrated his loving care for the members and friends the congregation who have experienced illness, undergone surgery, and have faced challenges and losses of various kinds. He is a man of faith. He has taught us well from your word, the Holy Bible. He proclaims clearly and applies directly the truths we need to know as growing disciples of Jesus Christ. He makes us feel comfortable and at ease when we talk with him personally. Today, we install him as our pastor and look forward in your providence to a spiritually enriching pastor-people relationship. We need the challenge of reaching out to our community and the world with the saving gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, both in the words we speak and the deeds we perform. Enable us who not only speak the truth in love, but also respond sensitively to the needs of those who live around us. This we ask in the strong and loving name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Because it's me, but because you have been faithful and God
about what I'm about to share. I didn't know what Dave and Brent would share. And we have had some unique experiences together through the years. I think Dave, you and I shared the Allegash Wilderness Waterway experience, the Burning Man canoe trip. We got lost. We ran into the camp. I want to say thank you to the search committee for your hard work and for your faithfulness to the call that God placed on your lives some 2 years ago, and even before that. Thank you to George Cole, to David Stolte, for your faithfulness to these people, these dear people. It's a pleasure, it was a privilege for me to get to know Ed and Roberta, and thank you so much for your faithful service to these people back from 72 to 83, and for the ability, for the privilege that's mine to look out on Sundays and see you worshiping here among us. Thank you so much for being here tonight with local area people, fellow pastors, ministers, ministry leaders. Thank you for coming and celebrating God's great man with Bethany. Thank you to my dad. Shall I say last, but certainly not least. We minister together. And I think I've been faithful and so good at helping me to get involved in ministry. And on weeks where there have been 60 hours, there have been 80 hours. They have been gracious to stand with me and to kind of walk that road. I want to say a few thoughts, and then I'm done because there are refreshments downstairs, and I don't want to miss those, and I don't want people to have to leave because they have to hit the road. And I want you to taste a little of the hospitality of the group. Here's an example. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And one of the things that I like to reflect on and I want to leave you with this evening is that perhaps for us, a little bit of the challenge is for us to bring heaven down. That we would do on earth what is done in heaven. And I want to suggest to you again four things that I spoke about that morning, that first Sunday morning. And then, first, God would give us and help us to be completely about glorifying our great God. That in heaven, the very hearts and the minds and the eyes, the voices, all that is done in heaven is given to glorify our great God. Because as we are learning on Sunday morning now, He truly is worthy. Not only glorify God, but to exalt His Son, Jesus Christ. Because we know, as it says in Revelation 5, worthy. Heavenly place of holiness. Those who gather around the throne are dressed in white. And so as a church, we give ourselves to glorifying God, we give ourselves to exalting Christ, and we give ourselves to living lives that are holy, lives that are exemplary, lives that mirror our great Savior, so that people would see in us with And then finally, we know that heaven is a place of unending service. I don't want to let next Sunday's sermon out of the bag because I didn't get to finish it today. But we know that gathered around that great throne are those who for all eternity serve the one who sits on the big throne. And so we, as we come together as a church, may it be that we give ourselves to serving our great God. That we would serve Him here, and that God would lead us to a greater commitment to serving Him the other 6 days of the week after that. Amongst our neighbors, our friends, our co-workers, and our families. God has great things in store for you, and for me, and for us. May we pray.
what?
We're not supposed to do this. You gotta get downstairs.